Hey guys, Parker Curtis here, back in the greenhouse. I'm here with my friend Matthew Gates, IPM expert. We're about halfway through harvest and through most of the heat, so we're gonna do a little bug scouting. We have a couple of examples to show you guys. And over here is a big old grasshopper. Yeah, I found three today, and they blend in very well. It's this bright green color, but they hide, they kind of stay very still, so you can't see them.
There are a lot of different grasshopper species out there, and here in Southern California, this might be what's called a bird grasshopper, or a short-horned grasshopper, potentially. I would have to look at it better to really understand and really be able to identify the species.
Yeah, and we saw a little baby one over there, but that thing looks like maybe a quarter of an inch at the most, and that one's a couple inches, so it seems like they grow pretty rapidly, but I think out of all the bugs that I have, that one's the least concerning. That one's just munching the fan leaves. So, I mean, I go through a couple of series of de-leafing and stuff. So that's not really affecting the buds the same way that the caterpillars are. So I've been feeding it to the spider, but not too worried about that one.
If anything, it's helping you de-leaf, right?
Yeah, it's putting it to work. I did find a couple other things over here though. Like we got, they look like little barnacles, and we found one. I've seen these last year, but I'm not familiar with these. This one's down here. It looks like a little barnacle kind of stuck to the leaf, and I'll usually see them on the stems. Is that one concerning? That can just kind of pull sap out and decrease vigor of the plants?
Yeah, so there's two different kinds of scale insects out there. There's soft scale and there's hard scale, and with cannabis, there's not a whole lot of different pests that have been documented in official channels, peer-reviewed research, that sort of thing. I've seen things like brown scale before, which might be what this is. But generally speaking, they're not a huge concern. In a lot of cases, they're just kind of a nuisance. They'll cluster around and they'll secrete honeydew, like other sap-feeding insects will do, and so that can foul the plants. Usually I see them in the foliage, but if they do happen to congregate closer to the bud, that can also be a fouling source.
Yeah, I did notice those last year, but because I've kept on it this year, I haven't seen near as bad a problem. So kind of this late stage of harvest, not every problem needs a solution, right? So we're close enough to harvest on these plants where you kind of have to weigh, is it worth applying any, you know, either organic or non-organic pesticide, especially with buds so close to harvest. You don't really want to apply anything and potentially harm yourself. So, and I also noticed some white flies too. I think that's some stuck in the spider web, but.
So they are. Yeah, white flies can be kind of a problem around this time. I've also seen them earlier as well. And if you're in a greenhouse or an indoor circumstance, then the seasonal pressures can be totally devoid from what happens indoor. You can have a population just continue and continue to grow, or you can have none.
Yeah, well, I noticed that with the heat and humidity that we just got through, there was kind of a blooming of insects. So we got through most of the season without any noticeable problem, but as it got super hot and humid, I saw a bunch of new bugs that I hadn't seen in here before. But you can see how those get caught in the spider webs, and one of the other bugs that we're going to be talking about is this huge spider here, and it's a little creepy coming through, especially at night. You don't want to have that get on you or walk through the web, but it's very helpful in the garden. It's like my little pet out here. It's nice to have around. Yeah, so let's check out some more of these. Yeah, I think on this plant too, I noticed some mites. They look like these little, I don't know if that's a good example of it, but I saw they almost had like a red hue, and I've dealt with spider
mites
before.
I see some thrips here, actually.
Okay.
You can see from the frass is liquid, so they have this sort of like black liquid exudate that they make, and then you can kind of see here along the mid rib there were some thrips. They might have actually moved at this point, but they like to be around here. They cause this sort of what's called stippling damage that gets on the leaf, and they can sometimes be underneath the leaf as well.
Yeah, with the thrips and some of the different mites and stuff, it's and the leaf miners for that matter, some of the signs that you'll see on the leaves that can be a little hard to diagnose until you see a full adult one. So, but like we were talking about inside was, what can you treat these with? And I know, I mean, for years, neem oil is a real popular one, but the problem with that, it leaves this oily residue. And especially with flowers almost ready to go, you got to be careful with what you apply and how, you know, if it's enough of a problem to take any preventative measures. So, you know, it's trying to find a balance of keeping these things pest-free and healthy versus, you know, not applying anything that's going to hurt you.
Generally speaking, when you get closer and closer to the harvest, like you say, I typically try to rely on other kinds of treatment measures. That's one reason why preventive measures are so important, of course, because you can reduce how much kind of ingresses into a greenhouse or that kind of a thing. But even so, sometimes the best option is just to physically remove, you know, especially like you mentioned, you only saw a few scale here, a little insect here, you know, not a huge issue, not going to cause your plants to become killed, you know, so.
Well, I know a lot of people are interested in ladybugs and little praying mantises, and I hadn't used those because I was spraying things. So I think maybe getting away from the spray, aside from the BT, but getting away from the sprays and later flower, maybe implementing this or the ladybugs and praying mantises later in the stage would be good. Since last time you were here, this spider, I've been feeding it every week and it's about doubled in size. Today alone, I fed it 2 grasshoppers. But this thing is gigantic, and I had one in the same area last year, so this thing is very nice to see in the greenhouse. Helps out a lot.
You help it a lot.
Yeah, but I have a problem with moths and butterflies, so them having this web up in the top of the greenhouse, you'll see a lot of these things get snagged up in it. And any butterfly that they catch is gonna do less damage to my plants, so I'm happy to see that.
I definitely agree. And especially in like a greenhouse with this sort of structure, it's very common to see sort of larger insects, some like moths and even things you might not want to kill, but like they get into the greenhouse and they kind of sort of get caught up in that plastic. So this is actually a really great place. I would be less interested in it if it were like, for example, all over your flower and that kind of a thing.
Yeah, yeah, this thing minds its own business and helps me out quite a bit.
Yeah, this is actually probably one of my favorite species. This, you call it a zipper spider. I know it by the silver agriope.
Yeah, that thing, it looks like it's dipped in silver. It's got a really cool coloring and you know, stays up pretty high, so it's less alarming than other spiders that I see around here.
You can definitely see it before it becomes a problem.
Yeah, yeah. So where is that grasshopper? Where did that thing go to?
That's a good question. Probably over here.
Well, we got another meal for that spider soon. So one of the last things that I saw was, oh, here. Now this thing, it looked kind of like those scale bugs, but you can see in here next to that caterpillar damage. That looks like a very large version of what we looked at over there, a little more furry though.
Yeah, so this is a mealybug. So this is kind of in the, or close to the soft scale group. They produce a bunch of like wax. Some of the wax here has been rubbed off, and that happens a lot when they brush up against other parts of the foliage and that sort of a thing. But they feed on the sap, just like the scale insects do. They produce honeydew, which is a sticky substance that can, you know, kind of be a problem. But generally speaking, they just stay in one place. As larvae, they move to other places, and then they pick a place, they stay there, they get older. Most of the population are females. They don't need a male to reproduce, and then they reproduce copious amounts of their own progeny, which then hatch and then go to, or are live birthed, other plants. And then that kind of starts all over again, so you'll get this sort of these waves. So to get rid of them, you have to be aware of their biology. You want to kill the adults, but the adults have this wax that makes it hard to apply things to. And if you only see a few of them, again, maybe
just
not.
Just
physically remove them.
Yeah, because I noticed I had some pests on this guava tree over here. So what we did on our off season was treat that, try to mitigate any potential problems for our harvest. So I sprayed down that tree with a pesticide that they'll normally use in greenhouses and on ornamental fruit trees. So I did two treatments of that, and it really knocked that down because that was a huge problem for me last year. So I guess keeping on top of these things and, you know, being outside, you're not going to get rid of all the bugs. You're not going to sterilize everything. It's just keeping the populations in check, right?
Yeah, you're going to have a constant pest pressure. People often ask me, what can I do to treat them? But then they'll ask, what can I do to repel them? And that's a very different question. You know, it's very hard. You really can't repel them with any sort of treatment. Anything noxious you'd want to apply, you probably don't want to be smoking. So when people are dealing with pests, they always have to constantly evaluate, are we going to have a lot of pests, or is it just kind of seasonal, only during summer? Yeah. Here, we kind of get them all the time.
I know, we have a huge growing season, and I mean, it's very temperate, so it's conducive to a huge bug population. So like we talked about, physical barrier, I'm going to tighten up, weather strip this doorway. And I know I've had a lot of interest in kind of companion planting, and we talked about they either have the trap plants can be a little dangerous, right? You can kind of have a separate vector for infection with those, but either the like some type of mint or basil or rosemary, those things will help kind of dissuade pests from coming in and around your garden a little bit, right?
Well, I'm not sure there will be a lot of dissuasion from the aromas, but you'll definitely attract a lot of the small parasitic wasps that love to drink all the little nectaries and all these little florets.
Okay.
And, you know, we even saw a while ago you had a little fall armyworm on your amaranth, and then I saw right next to it there was a parasitic wasp and probably one that would take care of it, potentially.
Yeah, so that's kind of the double-edged sword of treating with pesticides or things that will repel these bugs. You may potentially repel some of these beneficial predatory bugs. So that's it. Thanks again, guys. Follow us on Instagram at Homegrown World or on YouTube at Homegrown Cannabis Co. Thanks again, Matt Gates. See you next time.